Basketball season is past the midway point, and we're gearing up for district tournaments. We've got highlights and analysis here on the Fairfax Sports Report. Joining me in studio tonight, making his broadcast debut, Kyle Barr of the Northern Virginia Journal. Brian Bauer, broadcast veteran from Times Community Newspapers. We've got all that and more next on the Fairfax Sports Report. Welcome back. I'm Dan Rubin from the Northern Virginia Journal. Once again, joining me in studio tonight, Kyle Barr, boys basketball writer from the Northern Virginia Journal, and Brian Bauer, sports editor of Times Community Newspapers. First, let's thank our sponsors. As always, CCI Screen Printing. Strong Arm Sports. Them some strong arms. Always, House of Pain. U.S. Sports Online Strength and Conditioning Program, www.myworkoutprogram.com, trainer code 901701. www.houseofpain.com, put a little attitude in your workout. You can always visit our website if you have any questions or just want to shoot us an email, www.fairfaxsportsnetwork.com. Welcome back. All right, guys, we've passed the midway point. We're headed for the district tournaments. You guys have been on the beat for long enough now. Give me, Brian, give me two girls' teams we need to look out for as we head down the stretch here.
Two girls' teams I think you have to look out for, actually faced off last night, Jefferson and Chantilly. Jefferson's now 14-2, their only two losses of the season being to Chantilly. They've definitely got the tools. They've got the size. They're going to be a real factor as the season goes on. And Chantilly just keeps finding a way to win. They're a scrappy, smaller lineup, but believe me, they can shoot the three, and that's going to be trouble for any team that can't defend on the perimeter.
Kyle, this is your first year on the beat, but obviously some teams have kind of jumped up and caught your eye. We're going to take a look at the highlights right now. It looks like it's Herndon and TC Williams are two teams that have kind of separated themselves from the pack a bit.
Yeah, TC has really made a rise since losing to Mount Vernon early on in the season. Herndon's just been strong all season through.
Speaking of that, let's start off with some highlights here from last Friday night's game, probably the biggest game of the year so far in the Concord District. Herndon and South Lake squared off at Herndon. Capacity crowd, bunch of guys were turned away. I think what you're going to see here early on especially is Herndon's perimeter skills were just incredible. It was Ricky Lucas shooting the three. Brian, this rivalry, it seems like you were at the South Lakes game last week when they played Hayfield on Wednesday. Mm-hmm. South Lakes didn't get their best performance that night. What do you think brings out the best in South Lakes playing against Herndon?
Well, I mean, I think Herndon as a whole, the community rivalry, brings out the best in South Lakes. It's just one of these things, and unfortunately, as we all know, this is the last time that Herndon and South Lakes are going to hook up for a district game. They'll be out of district, obviously, next season, but they will continue to play. But I just really think that their players, their coaches, their coaches used to work with each other. The communities are so tightly intertwined. These kids live right down the street from each other. They've grown up playing together. When these kids get out and play and meet twice a season or whatever, it's the biggest game in town, and everyone in the community is there.
I think what you saw this game early on, Bo Taylor really kind of dominated inside and from the wing, as you see right here from South Lakes. Very impressed with the defensive effort that Herndon put forth in the second half. In retrospect, Herndon battled a lot of foul trouble in the first half, especially the inside guy, Brian Boyle. And in retrospect, like I was saying, I think South Lakes just needed to have about a 10-point lead in this game at halftime. That was their opportunity to kind of build the lead. Even when they got up in the second half, Herndon really showed they have some resolve. They're a perimeter-oriented team, but they have really a nice blend of talent. They've got also some young players that have really started to contribute. Number 11, Scotty Reynolds, you see there at the bottom of your screen, has really turned into a force. They've got four guys who can really shoot the three. When your leading scorer is not really a three-point shooter, which is Ricky Lucas, I mean, his addition has really helped the team. I also thought Herndon made some nice adjustments in this game. You're going to see a play coming up here where Scott Reynolds gets the ball kicked to him on the wing. And the first time these teams played, which is a win for Herndon. He hit the big three-pointer, and then this game he was able to kind of draw the defense and kick it to Brad Farrell for a key three-pointer. And they've also got Jordan Short, number 22. Here's the play I'm actually referring to. That was really the biggest shot of the game right there. They gave him a six-point lead late in the game. Very impressive. Has Herndon surprised you at all this year, Brian?
I wouldn't say surprised. I mean, I think everyone pretty much expected them to be one of the best teams in the region. They've lived up to that. I think maybe the surprise is that they really haven't run into any adversity as the season's gone on. I think that's a direct tribute to Gary Hall and how he's kept the program under control, and they haven't gotten real big heads as the season's gone on.
We had the chance, myself and John Kime, to be inside. Let's talk about Bo Taylor, 29 points. That's his season high. Doug McLaughlin-Williams, 15. Most of that in the first half, though. Ricky Lucas, 21. Jordan Short, 15. 72-70 with a cosmetic three-pointer at the end for South Lakes. What I was saying earlier is I've been very impressed with Herndon's very much a cohesive unit. Got a chance to go behind the scenes a little bit for some stuff we're doing for the Journal this week. Just very impressed. I think, you know, at least my impression was I was going to get in there and hear a lot of yelling and screaming at halftime, stuff like that. No one ever raised their voice, anything like that. So I think if there's a team to beat right now in the Northern region, it has to be Herndon. It's getting to the point now where they're pretty much taking everybody's best punch. Let's check out some scores from Tuesday night, rather. Very important games around the region. West Springfield and Hayfield. West Springfield was really the B team on the rise. Had beaten both Hayfield and TC for the first time in at least 6 years. Last night, though, Kyle, you were there. West Springfield kind of ran into a buzzsaw. They let Mike Lee get hot from three-point land. As we know, that's not something you can do.
Yeah, and a far different West Springfield team than Friday night when they came back to beat TC Williams at West Springfield's gym. Went into the Hawks' nest and things look a lot different for them inside.
What was the difference? I know that against TC, which is a very big team, West Springfield kind of had their way. What was the difference? What was Hayfield able to do to kind of slow down Marshall Osbury?
Hayfield, they went front and back on Osbury when he would bring it into the post. They'd have someone fronting him, and then someone that would, once he brings the ball up, swipe it away from him. I think they had one or two blocks like that early on that kind of, I think, shook his confidence. And he just really wasn't able to get into the game. Had 0 points, yeah. 0 rebounds.
And I think it's fair to say if West Springfield doesn't get any production from their big guy inside, they're not really going too far. Our next score in the National District, really the team that's kind of been a surprise to me this year of any team, is Falls Church. Undefeated in the district, 65-60 over Wakefield. Stephen Papageorge, 17 points. Marvin Carthon, 16 points and 4 assists. Jeffrey Crowley led Wakefield with 16 points. Perhaps the most impressive part of this, Thomas Falahimi didn't play in this game. Falls Church, who in their district do you think can challenge them?
Mount Vernon is always a threat. They're the defending district champions. They've had a few problems with injuries, a few chemistry problems, but they're always strong, hanging in there. They beat Wakefield. Wakefield was one of the up-and-coming teams, especially after beating Mount Vernon in the district opener. So it's going to be an interesting race once the tournament starts.
All right, moving on to our next score here. Possibly one of the bigger upsets of this year so far, an undefeated team to go down. That's Madison taking out W.T. Woodson. The first time these two teams played, Woodson won by about 25 points, and Johnny Ayers' comment after the game, Madison's point, was hopefully we can cut the deficit in half. Well, obviously they did a little bit more than that. Ayers is kind of putting on a late run against Jose Alvaro for player of the year in the Liberty District.
Yeah, he really is. He's one of these players that gets everything done, and you can see him really trying out there on the court. It seems like any lacking that his team has, he's running around trying to make up for it, everything he can do. And the amazing thing is the kid's been sent to the free throw line. 3 games ago, he'd already been sent to the free throw line 100 times this season. So, you know, at this point, he's probably up 120, 130 times. That's unbelievable, and he's shooting an 80% tilt. So, I mean, the point's right there.
Very quick off the dribble and very good at getting to the basket and drawing contact. I know that Herndon and Woodson were supposed to play tomorrow night. Do you think that those being the last two teams that hadn't lost to a region opponent coming into last night, do you think Woodson may have gotten caught looking ahead a little bit?
I think... You know, that's probably a little bit of what the coach might tell you was going on. I mean, they know that game is the game in the region that everyone's going to have their eyes on. They're having a great season, 15-0 coming into last night. They faced McLean on Friday. They had Madison on Tuesday. Two teams they dominated by a total of 50 points between them in the two times they played them earlier. And knowing that they had Herndon, you know, right now the self-appointed best team in the region, they've got so much to prove. They want to make sure that everyone knows who they are and everything. Maybe they did get caught at looking a little bit.
I think, I mean, this is just my opinion. I think that's a tough game for Woodson. Going into the Hornets' Nest, like we said, that's going to be the best team they faced all year.
Sure.
Woodson had had a great season so far, at least as far as our poll. They had not faced a ranked team so far. So I think if their confidence is shaken at all from the loss to Madison, they're going to be in trouble Friday night. But what they do have is seniors and a great player. And anytime you have that combination, I think you have a shot. Checking out our next score here, Langley and Marshall, another Liberty District tilt. Not exactly your high-scoring affair from head coach of Langley, Brian Doyle, and his former assistant, now head coach at Marshall, Kevin Wiern. Langley, Will Monica, the standards. Will Monica, Michael Hassan, 10 points. Marshall Cruzio, Washington, 11 points. Kwame Sappho, 9 points, 2 3-pointers. Langley, kind of an enigmatic team this year. They also lost a game to Madison. Is Langley really right now the biggest threat to Woodson Liberty District? What about Fairfax?
Well, I mean, I think that Langley certainly has the tools, and they're wonderfully coached by Brian Doyle, who's been doing it for a while now and obviously knows what he's doing. At Fairfax, though, Fairfax was the early favorite coming into this season. You know, they had the tools to get all the way to the regional semis last year. They had a great cast of returning players coming back. I think you'd have to assume at this point that, given the fact that they're only about a game out of first place right now, right, that really, in my opinion, makes it, they realize they can get this title before it's all over. They're the team to watch, in my opinion, the Liberty.
I think, if anything, Madison has maybe launched himself into a position where they're going to be competing for a region tournament bid, but I think those four teams have clearly kind of pulled away from the rest of the pack.
Yeah, definitely.
And I think the title should come from Woodson, Fairfax, or Langley. If Madison can pull it off, though, I think Johnny Ayers will be the reason.
Sure.
Looking at our final boys' score, T.C. Williams and Lake Braddock. Lake Braddock obviously has fallen on some hard times after winning their first Patriot District title last year. T.C. Williams has had a couple, really, I mean, they did lose to West Springfield last Friday night, Kyle, but they have really just dominated a couple. They beat Annandale by over 50 points and Lake Braddock. What is it that T.C. has that allows them to kind of blow teams out like that?
They really have a strong inside-outside game, with Willie Shaw inside being probably the most dominant post player in the Northern region. They also have a real competent point guard in Richard Hunter. Short guy, but he can really penetrate. He did that against Hayfield. And they have guys that can shoot outside, dribble inside, and pick up shots too.
I think one thing about TC is they went with youth last year, and all these guys have gotten a year of experience. That tends to help them. Coming off a year 2 years ago when they won the region title, they really played mostly seniors. And they lost their only young player, Darian Towns, who's now Carolyn's committed to Georgetown. So TC, I think, is a team that definitely has as much talent or more talent than any team in the region. And I think if you took a poll of coaches who they don't want to face in the region tournament, I think TC would come up on everybody's ballot. Moving on to the ladies, girls basketball. Chantilly, aside from West Springfield, probably the hottest team in the region. Started out 0-3. They won 14 straight games. I don't care what sport it is. You win 14 straight games, you are hot. Brian, we talked about this a little bit before the show. You were at the game. Elena Kashansky, I have to throw in a plug here, the Journal Player of the Year from last year, 17 points and 4 steals. Caitlin Gorski, 15 points from Jefferson. Maddie Regan and Adrian Young. We talked about this, though. So both losses for Jefferson are to Chantilly, also notable. But Chantilly has had a penchant falling behind early and kind of coming back late. That was the same last night as well.
Yeah, in fact, they've done it in two of their last three games. They fell behind against Herndon at Chantilly and managed to make up the deficit. Herndon a little outmanned in that game. But against Jefferson, they were absolutely dominated in the first half, Dan, like nothing I've seen against them all season. They're down by 7 at halftime, which isn't the worst deficit in the world, but it was the way that 7 came about. I mean, they just really seemed to have no idea how to defend Jefferson whatsoever, and Jefferson was really getting it done with a lot of fundamental basketball. After the game, Coach Kelly told me that nothing that they did that they normally do right, that is their strengths, worked in that game for them. And what they ended up doing was they went away from the threes, they ended up going away from the long stuff, the perimeter stuff, and basically took a cue from Jefferson, went to fundamental basketball, and it worked. They managed to trim the lead down all the way to a tie ball game at the end of the third, take the lead in the fourth, and that was it.
They have Elena Kashansky and Gorski, like we saw those names up there. That's senior leadership from the guard spot. High school basketball is really a guards game.
Sure.
How much has that helped them down the stretch in the fourth quarter?
I think it's helped them a lot. They have... To their credit, they have some very good big men on that team. I mean, Lisa Harkness is very, very good inside, but they definitely have their strength, like you said, from Gorski and Kashansky, who are their leading scorers, and they really seem to spark them. Gorski last night comes into the third quarter basically with no points in the game, comes out, grabs a couple of steals, makes free throws, starts hitting some long shots or whatever. Next thing you know, she's got 15 points in the third quarter alone.
They also got a nice performance down low from Kate Wooldridge.
Right, right. Kate Wooldridge came into the game in the third quarter. Again, it seemed like Kelly was kind of mixing it up in the first half, couldn't really find an answer. Both of them performed really well in the second half, and that was a difference. Still, though, something to watch was Chantilly, even at the end of the game, and Kelly pointed this out, had trouble sinking their free throws. They couldn't put the game away. Jefferson was basically handing it to them in the end, not being able to make their shots. Chantilly couldn't find their stroke at the free throw line, and Jefferson almost made it interesting.
Got a chance to see Jefferson last year in the district tournament in an overtime loss to Herndon, but they're a team that also had a lot of young players last year. It looks like that experience has helped them really. Good young point guard in Kendall Stone. Mm-hmm. Got, you know, they have all the pieces. It just seems like they have kind of a Chantilly jinx going at this point.
Sure, and I mean, and they're led by Julie Miller, who's a fantastic player. And you know, I think they're going to be able to go as far as she can take them.
Moving on to Herndon and Centerville from Tuesday night. 54-42. picking up a little speed here. I'm sorry, I skipped Madison. Sorry, Vienna and Fairfax. Madison Woodson. This is a huge win for Woodson. 42-40. Mary Beth Brown, 22 points and 6 rebounds for Madison. Lee Campman, 10 points. Adriana LaMature for Woodson, 17 points. Mary Clavin, 9 points and 9 rebounds. This is the first district loss for Madison since midway through last season.
Yeah.
Woodson is a team that has really come on of late.
Yeah,
talk about those young players. Adriana LaMature is one of those players who someone should keep their eye on.
Right. Mary Clavin as well. I mean, Woodson has been very quiet this season. You know, you wouldn't know it unless you opened up the paper and looked at the fact that they're 11-4 right now, that they're really enjoying quite a successful run. Obviously, the boys program getting a lot of credit and stuff. They've got a good young team that just keeps continuing to get in other teams' way. It should be interesting to watch down the stretch how they perform against the Liberty District. And a win against Madison is huge, no matter which way you cut it.
Madison, certainly the Liberty District heavyweight and have been for some time.
Quite some time.
Now moving on to Herndon and Centerville. So I get my timing right here. Herndon 54, Centerville 42. Katie Haddell 18 points. Kyle DeHaven 13 for Herndon in the win. Harrison Dolan 14-11 respectively for Centerville. Very surprising to see Kyle DeHaven not at the top of the scorers board there. But talk a little about Kyle DeHaven last week in 2 games, 36.5 points.
Sure.
Really probably the most prolific scorer in the region right now, almost a one-man show.
What's interesting about Kyle is this game, while she might not have been a leading scorer, as you pointed out, might have actually been her best game of the season. She finished with a triple-double in this game. Her first of the season, and my criticism of her play early in the season is she seems like she needs to go with kind of a one-man show mentality, that she's the only person on the team who can score, so she tends to force a lot of stuff. It seemed like the other night she settled down a little bit, gets a triple-double, they win fairly easily.
She's an extremely talented player. She's been playing next year at William & Mary, and sometimes you can't blame her for that mentality and that. She, you know, she'll pass the ball around. Her teammates miss a couple of shots. She kind of feel like I got to do this myself.
And to her credit, I mean, that really seems like the direction Herndon wants to go in. They know that if they're going to win, they have to get the ball into her hands.
All right, our final girls basketball score here: Robinson 62, Annandale 48, Cassie Hammond 13 points, Tiffany McCain 13 points, and Betsy Toller 13 points for Robinson. A very balanced effort. And for Annandale, Nicole Finney with 13 points. Robinson's a team you haven't heard much about.
12-4,
and you know, in the Patriot District, obviously West Springfield is going to get the pub.
Sure.
They haven't lost to a team in this region since the semifinals 2 years ago in the region tournament. Is Robinson a team that can legitimately threaten West Springfield for district and region titles?
No doubt. You know, they're going to make their stand sooner or later. They've struggled in their only meeting with West Springfield earlier this season, but they certainly have the tools. And it's one of those things where the success with that Robinson girls program is so long and so steeped. They know they can do it. It may not work out on paper, but I wouldn't be surprised if they manage to pull it off.
I'm going to try something a little bit new here on the Fairfax Sports Report. A little bit of hockey coverage. And for that, Lee Bailey. Take it away, Lee.
Thanks, guys. Good to be here with you tonight. We're going to be talking about hockey in Northern Virginia Scholastic Hockey League. It's not affiliated with Fairfax County Public Schools in any way or their sporting departments, but nonetheless, we have high school athletes who are going to be playing hockey in the area, and we've got highlights for you. We'll start you off with highlights of the Centerville area and Westfield area hockey clubs. Centerville had goals by Daniel Germano, Matthew Biderson. Westfield had goals by Cale Willis, Christopher Smith, Kyle Rogers, and Kevin Millman. couple nice saves. Looks like pretty decent hockey here. Westfield scoring 4 goals and Centerville making a valiant attempt to come back. Ended up scoring 2 goals against Westfield. Slow-mo. And that was the final score of that game. They also had a game with Oakton versus Herndon, as we stated before. The next game we have highlights from. Do we have highlights from the Oakton 4, Herndon, South Lakes 2? A little combination going on there. Oakton had Alex Stitt with 2 goals. Matt Hulse, Tyler Zivic, each with 1 goal. Look at Pittsburgh Penguins there. Herndon, South Lakes, goals scored by Patrick Bierman, Timothy McCarthyich, each had a goal. Nice save, and unfortunately couldn't wrap it up. I think Oakton's had a program for a couple years now. The Oakton area kids. And there you have it again, NBHSL, SHL scores. Oakton 4, Herndon 2. Next game we had Stonewall Jackson with 2 goals against Woodbridge Potomac. A little combination of the two areas getting together and putting together some scoring. As you can see, 5 goals scored by Woodbridge, goals by Sean Collin, Ty Peters, Steve Sockholm, and that's basically your hockey news. No, we got one more. North Stafford versus Oakton. Oakton had 2 games the last week. Oakton 6, North Stafford 4. And as you can see, the guys who scored the points, Benjamin Boggs with 2 goals, that's sweet. And a hat trick by Matt Hulse. Guess what, guys? That's it for hockey. I'm going to kick it back to you guys for basketball.
Thanks, Lee. I'm going to talk a little bit now about what we got coming up on the docket here this coming Friday night. These become huge games for everybody. We've got about 4 or 5 district games left to go. First up, West Springfield at Annandale. Annandale's kind of a team that's had some tough times this year. All the new players on the team. West Springfield, like you said, they're a little flat the other night, Kyle. It's important for them to kind of get back on track.
Yeah, that's right, Dan. They're currently tied right now with Hayfield, who they lost to. They split the season series. TC Williams stands a game ahead of both of them in first place. They got to win every game that they can take to just have a chance at that top spot, that automatic bid to the regional tournament.
That's huge. Like you're saying, West Springfield, Hayfield, TC, those are really the 3 favorites right now. I think, like you said, a loss to any other team besides those two, I think they can pretty much bank on being in the top half of the bracket with the number 1 seed. All right. Also, Chantilly at Oakton, a big time Concord District matchup. Very big game for Oakton. Oakton has really not been able to catch its stride this year. This is a team that started off kind of like this last year, but about this time last year, they already started to pick it up. 5 starters back, and they haven't really been able to get back on track.
Yeah, Coach Kublink was a little concerned about this coming into the season, that the football hangover was going to kind of get to them a little bit. I don't know if that's the case. They just really haven't been able to find their rhythm. I think they're 6-10 at this point this season. But, you know, hey, they've got the tools, obviously, to get there. It's the same guys from last season.
Absolutely, same starting 5 back. Another Concord District matchup, Westfield at Centerville. Very big game for Westfield, which is really going to try and get that 4th spot in the Concord District. A loss to Centerville, which is kind of in the 6th or 7th spot right now, would really damage that. We've also got Langley at Fairfax, which is a huge Liberty District game. If for no other reason, these teams are battling to get in position to kind of go at Woodson. Langley won the first game. Mm-hmm. What do you expect us to look for in this game?
I expect to see Fairfax really strengthen their hold a little bit. I realize they're right in the thick of things, and it's still pretty much anybody's district at this point, especially with Woodson falling the other night. Fairfax knows they've got the talent to win this district. They've had it since the season started. It's just a question of putting it all together and making it happen. And it begins by beating Langley Friday night.
And much like Oakton last year, Fairfax really picked it up towards the end of the season. They need to do that right now if they want to be really considered one of the elite teams. Well, we thank you guys for being here. We're going to take a look at this week, the Fairfax Sports Network Game of the Week this week. Langley at Fairfax, a game we just talked about. Probably the biggest Liberty District tilt for both of these teams this year in terms of importance. Our cameras will be there, and we'll have highlights of that for you next week. If you'd like to order copies of past Fairfax Sports Network programming, just go to our website, www.fairfaxsportsnetwork.com. All right, guys, we appreciate you being here, and we'll see you guys next week on the Fairfax Sports Report.